2007 was, for me, a year of planes, trains, and Jane. Well, mostly planes and a few trains, and I'll tell you about my friend Jane in a minute. Early in the year, I flew from the frozen mountains of Montana to the frozen, wet, and windy climes of jolly old England to attend the Blackpool Pigeon Show. I love Blackpool, not for the weather, mind you. Who but 25,000 pigeon fanciers would come to an ancient seaside resort town in January, when the North Atlantic is about as unfriendly as she gets? But once you're warm and dry inside the grand old exhibit halls, it's a chance to meet old friends, show films, and wallow in the warmth and good cheer of an ocean of pigeon racers, all excited that this spring, this year, might be their breakthrough season. Blackpool is ostensibly a pigeon show, but although the grand hall is given over to cages of racing birds and show homers, the thin crowd in here hides the fact that hallways and rooms where the trade stands are set up are jammed with fanciers. This is where every type of racing pigeon, pigeon food, pigeon loft, or pigeon anything is on sale. And at the end of the day, they're buying done. These thousands of fanciers jam the pubs for non-stop late-night storytelling about their victories or plans for victories in the race seasons to come. After the show, I spent time with Chris Gordon and the group that was organizing the UK's entries for the upcoming Olympiad in Belgium. The group's appointed by the RPRA to select British birds with the best flying record or the best show birds to compete against the best in the world. Frank Casper was among the fanciers, entering a hen that had won 11 top prizes in major races in 05 and 06, including first and third national. Also working with the committee was photographic legend Peter Bennett. Taking portraits of the Olympiad team is all in a day's work for Peter, who over the past 35 years has photographed something on the order of 60,000 race winners, not only in the UK, but all over the world. This master not only has his magic box, but infinite patience to get the right shot. And of course, with nervous pigeons, shall we say, sitting for their portrait, he never runs out of tissues. The UK team was excited about their prospects at the Olympiad, which is held every other year, and in 2007 was included in Belgium's national show at the port city of Ostend. The show is a blend of what we would call standard and sporting classes, basically picture-perfect unflown show racers and the working class, birds with several thousand racing miles under their able wings. Like Blackpool, Ostend was a little bit about official events such as the show and the annual awards for Belgium's best flyers, as much as it's about buying birds and baskets and having beers with old friends. One thing you do notice about the annual Belgian event is that it's truly a national showcase. With so many pigeon fanciers competing in a small nation, combined with an extremely precise national point system, it's indeed possible to denote those fanciers who were the best regionally and nationally in everything from sprint, middle distance, long distance, and overall race performance. The huge stage is filled all day long with a parade of winners in dozens of categories. Happily, you see a lot of relatively younger men taking their walk up here. But then again, some of their elders won't be denied, such as Marcel Albrecht, who you met in Secrets 2, and who won Champion of All Belgium. What did this 80-year-old win this time? Champion of All Belgium for the second year in a row. Speaking of winning, how did the Royal Association's representatives fare at the Olympiad? Well, all the Queen's men won, for the first time ever, actually tying the Polish team as the best of the 15 nations who entered their pigeons. In the all-round class, Frank's hen took fifth world, and his good friend Mickey Betts took a fourth. After the Olympiad, I returned with the British team to the UK, where I spent some time with Frank as he worked with his first round of winterbred youngsters. Some material we'll share with you later. After that, it was wheels up and back to Montana for some other film projects until I was back on the road again in August to spend the heart of my summer in the midst of the young bird season in Europe. It's 600 driving miles from Montana to Seattle, and then 5,000 miles to Amsterdam, where I flew before taking a shuttle to northern England. Now, Frank Tasker would have you believe that I make this my base in the UK because of his words of wisdom, but that's not it at all. I love the rural farm country in Lincolnshire, England's vegetable garden, if you will. Where else are you going to find five different tractor magazines in the newsagents? And of course, there's no finer hostess in the British Isles and Frank's wife, Ann.
What's going on?
Frank was in the midst of his young bird season, as were other friends who often travel with me when I haul my camera from country to country. So I was on my own for this trip, and this is where the train portion of our story comes in. Let's just say English roads are a little more crowded than I'm used to in remote Montana, so I opted to take the train to Jeff Kirkland's home near Stoke-on-Trent. Now, English friends sometimes complain about their trains, but to me, they're terrific. Let me put that in perspective. From where I live, it's over 200 miles just to the nearest train station. And service, well, the state of Montana is 3 times the size of England. And do you know how many trains we have a day in Montana? 2. 1 east, 1 west. So being able to get on at the little station at Waynefleet, a town the size of mine in Montana, where the train goes through more than 24 times a day, is a luxury. Sometimes carrying a video camera has its perks, and it did on English trains. Several conductors were curious about what I was doing, including this nice guy, Simon, who, seeing my camera, learning I was a filmmaker, asked if I wanted to get some better shots, and then let me sit in the engineer's seat.
Now, I'm not running this train. Simon's given me a chance to see what it's like in the engineer's cab, which is very cool. Same controls as if I was going
in the opposite direction. Yeah.
Opposite direction. So when you get where you get to the end, the engineer just walks to the end and
changes the direction. That's right.
Of course, I was not driving. There's a seat at either end of the train, and I got to go to the back. You take a short ride from a small town to a bigger station, and usually wait about 10 minutes before your next ride pulls through. It's a wonderful, relaxed way to get from point A to B and see the English countryside, although sometimes at 80-plus miles an hour, it goes by pretty fast. As usual, Jeff and his wife Barbara were having a good season. I can report he won his section 3 times, but most important to Jeff, managed to win a prize at the end of the year that he's been after for as long as he's flown in national competition. That's the National Flying Club's trophy for the fancier with the best overall national average, combining both his young bird and old bird averages. When I visited in August, young bird racing was just starting, and Jeff had put his separated youngsters together to start to get them in various nest positions for the bigger national races coming up. He and Barbara belong to 2 small local clubs and do their part in the workload. And these friendly pub-based racing clubs are Jeff's gateway to enter the nationals. After a nice 2-day visit and a great interview, it was back on the train and ultimately over to the continent. Sadly, I was not able to take in Ireland on this trip, but I will say for you fans of the phenomenal Ronnie Williamson and Paul Gregg of Gregg Brothers McCandless Loft, they are still as big a threat on the Emerald Isle as ever. Ronnie won yet another All-Irish National, as well as the Open and the Young Bird Classic from Sennin Cove, the same race that Paul and his brother Stephen won last year. You'll hear a little from both of them later, as I did have a chance to talk with them about young bird racing on previous trips. It's a 1-hour flight from Northern England to Amsterdam Airport, where I rented a car and began my first solo excursion through the motorways and winding country roads that lead to the countless small villages in this part of the world. Well, I wasn't alone. I had Jane. Who's Jane? Well, here's what she looks like. Pretty cute, with a wonderful British accent. But I can't show you an actual picture of her because Jane is the lovely voice on the GPS system that I use to find my way through the torturous tangle of tiny roads that lead to my pigeon friends on the continent. Thanks to Jane, you can enter an address, push a button, and she takes over, telling you exactly where and when to turn and when you have...
After 300 meters, you have reached your destination.
I may be giving you more details than you want to know about my trip, but let me tell you, if you've ever been afraid to visit pigeon people in a strange country, a friend like Jane totally changes the game. She never failed to get me where I wanted to go. And where I wanted to go first was to pay my respects to Paul Halterman. I'm sad to say that last year, the professor had to say goodbye to his pigeons. Now in his 80s, the demands of staying in the game combined with his wife's serious allergy to birds have our old friend spending his days tending his garden and reminiscing about his triumphs of the past among his dusty old trophies and former loft. Paul is still spunky, and he doesn't have much nice to say about modern young bird racing, but it's easy to understand why, because the game has changed so much, it's hard for one of the titans of the past to fathom the changes in this part of the sport. From Paul's village, I headed to the port of Ghent, where young Dirk van den Driessche now works in the huge port operations center. Paul Halterman is not alone in his concern about the direction of young bird racing, as you'll hear from Dirk. But remember that he and his family are classic long-distance flyers, saving their young birds for a long career at 400-mile old bird stations. Next day, after visiting Dirk, I headed to the veterinary clinic of Johan van der Kruisen and his wife Greta. As one of Belgium's leading pigeon clinics, this is a place where 50 to 100 fanciers a week bring their birds or droppings for analysis. Greta is every bit as much the pigeon vet as Johan and does a lot of the clinical testing. As you'll hear in a later episode, a growing amount of this work is what they call Gram stain tests. This is where the droppings are analyzed by heating the sample and applying special stains. Why? It's the fastest method to determine if a bird has a yeast infection, an almost invisible malady that is more and more a result of over-medication with antibiotics. From the clinic, the next destination I punched into the GPS was back up north in Holland, where Jane told me how to find Ad Sherlocken's house. Ad, as always, keeps winning races and writing about our sport in his very special style. Since he was asked to stop pooling and then racing young birds all together in Holland several years ago, he's partnered with a pair of retired brothers in Belgium and has continued to rack up terrific results in both old bird and young bird races. It always takes about the first hour of a visit to get caught up on what he's won, and I decided to interview him in his trophy room this year, so you'd get a feel for the amount of hardware this Dutch champion has hauled home over the years. It was a great interview, and I promised Ad I'd tell you he has a new book coming out this year, a collection of all his most popular articles. So there you go, Ad. There's your plug, my friend. The next day, I told Jane our final destination would be a one-block-long street called Huelstraat in the little village of Zengem in West Flanders. This was a new destination not only for Jane, but for me as well. And there are two famous fanciers on Huelstraat who week after week think first and foremost about beating the street before they worry about their national race results. The two flyers who live opposite each other are the van de Hiede brothers, Jack and Freddie. Between the two of them, who both learned racing from their grandfather and father, they have something like 100 top 10 national wins over the last decade with young birds, yearlings, and hens. Although 14 years apart, they enjoy a relaxed level of competition and spend a lot of time trading birds and talking about their methods. Freddie, the youngest, is the principal of an elementary school in the village, and with the strongest English was my choice for an interview. It's not the first time he's been recognized outside Belgium. My friend Ray Knight did a video on him and his methods a few years ago. And between Jack and Freddie, you won't find a pair of more dangerous men in young bird racing in Belgium. You know, I said earlier I was sad Paul Halterman no longer has pigeons, but you should know something that connects the van de Hiedes and Frank Tasker, basically champions of two different countries. The foundation of both these Belgian and English lofts form a strong, direct line back to the birds of Menk Halterman, Paul's original racing partner. So even if the professor is not in the game today, the blood of his birds will live long after him with men who honor the greatness of his breeding skills. Freddie is a relaxed and friendly person and very enjoyable to talk to. I should mention here that his loft and Jack's are a little different than what you see in a lot of other places. Not only is there deep straw, but the entire young bird section is a maze of boards leaning against the wall, straw bales with hiding places behind them, and more cardboard boxes than you'd see in a grocery store. The reason, as you'll hear later, is Freddie's young bird methods revolve, at least at the national racing level, around getting his young birds into the perfect nest position. And he'll spend hours observing his birds and doing things like putting a board between two nests, gradually sliding them close together, and then removing the board just before the two unwitting neighboring hens are shipped to a race. After two visits with Jack and Freddie, Jane told me how to get back to the airport in Amsterdam, and I returned to the UK, where I got a chance to go to the shipping for the NRCC's Young Bird National. Electronic timing and traditional timing are now part of the scene in the UK. I think about a quarter of the competitors so far had changed over to the new computer systems. This Young Bird National is the race Frank destroyed last year, and even though he topped the Fed five times this year and put over two dozen birds in the top 75, he didn't win the race. However, his friend, Dave Evans, who took the Fed in third national, had a few choice words for the man he beat.
Oh, advice, told him what to do. What to do in the loft, what little bits to do, I'm not saying what, but, you know, good advice.
My final project was a visit to PJ Lofts and Feed Store, where the Newbold family were kind enough to let me set up an area to record a feed mixing demonstration that appears in our special feature section. Then, Jane went into my suitcase, and I flew back to Montana, only to fly out again a week later for the blistering heat of Spring Hill, Florida, home of the greatest concentration of champion American trainers. There I stayed with an old friend, Jim Bennett, and spent time with three of the top men in Spring Hill. If you can truly say anybody is able to stay on top in what is without a doubt the toughest racing in the hemisphere. Since we're talking about America, I can tell you something about the fanciers in Pennsylvania and the Chicago and Los Angeles areas. They are not unhappy to see these three dangerous men move away to Florida. Randall Berkey was a legend in Pennsylvania. Art Hees, one of the most dangerous men in the hotbed of LA's Fernando Valley. And former school administrator Horst Hackamer drove his competitors wild when he raced outside Chicago. I've included some of these three in several chapters, but saved their best for last in our final chapter called The Finish Line. So, planes, trains, and Jane. A journey of over 25,000 miles to shoot about 30 hours of material that we've now boiled down to the essence of what some of the best men in the game want to tell you about Young Bird Racing.